If you remember, what we have been doing is we have been studying the perturbation of, in density and velocity fields for dark matter and baryons. And we showed that it is much easier to do it in the linear approximation, and we have worked out how to do it in linear approximation, how the perturbations grow. We also saw that under certain conditions it's probably possible to do it in the quasi-linear approximation also, in the quasi-linear regime. Particularly for dark matter. Nonlinear regimes, one has to go to simulation. And then we also saw that this linear theory is actually much more helpful than we realized earlier. So linear theory breaks down when the over densities or the density contrasts tend to become of the order of unity. But we saw that it's still useful if we continue to solve the linear evolution beyond its regime of validity. So for that, we actually worked out what is known as the spherical collapse. And we showed that when the linear density contrast takes a particular value, which is usually called the critical density, which is of the order of 1.69. So the name of this thing is critical density, or critical density contrast. So the moment the linear density contrast crosses this threshold, we said that that region is very likely to collapse and form a bound object. Okay? Ultimately, those are the places where galaxies will form. You should also remember that linear perturbation theory and spherical collapse, these are the two things which can be worked out analytically, very well. So any cosmological model you have beyond the standard model, and if you want to work out the perturbation, the first two things to try would be linear perturbation theory and spherical collapse. They are the easiest to deal with. Anything more you want to do, things will become much more complicated. Now that is all, till now we have been doing what I should call the time evolution or the temporal evolution of the perturbation. We still haven't talked anything about the spatial distribution. Remember, we wrote delta Tx, even in the linear approximation, as some dt times some fx. So the question to ask is, what about this fx? In the linear theory, the advantage is if I specify this fx at the initial epoch, when things were very small, the perturbations were very small, then that is it. I don't have to do anything more because this I have already solved. So I will get the density contrast at any later epoch without any problem, as far as the linear theory is concerned. And again, I have been telling you that linear theory is very good. You can actually keep on evolving using this even when delta becomes larger than 1. That still will give you some idea about where highly nonlinear objects will form. So fine, so we have to understand this quantity, fx, or equivalently rho x, at a given epoch. Let us say some early epoch, and that's where we want to understand. Now the first thing to realize is that this density inhomogeneities, most likely, we don't know how they actually originated, what are the reasons why they actually, density perturbations exist in the universe at all. But whatever it is, the current belief is there would be some quantum fluctuations at some very early universe, which we don't understand what exactly that is. And that would give rise to inhomogeneity. Now, whatever this is, if this is a quantum process, you can understand that this will be highly probabilistic. So even if you start with a completely homogeneous background and all the points are equivalent, so you can ask the question that why suddenly this point will become overdense and this point will become underdense. And the only explanation one can have is probably some quantum effects played a role, which is probabilistic. So probabilistically, some points got overdensity, some points got underdensity. So essentially what we are seeing, if finally we see some field like this, it is nothing but a random field, it's a probabilistic random field. And we are just, what we are observing is a realization of a random process, essentially, and nothing else. So that is the paradigm in which we will work. So the rho density field, or even the velocity field, or any other potential field which you can think about. What we are observing is nothing but basically a random field. So what we should be talking about are the statistical properties of this field. So in other words, when I'm trying to compare with observations, see, all these things are being done to compare with observations. I mean, that is the main thing. I mean, we want to explain the galaxy, I mean, the distribution of galaxies we see and so on. So when I try to compare with observations, I should not, like, try to, I mean, construct a model where I will say that, oh, here there is a Milky Way, here there is Andromeda, and there I see local group and things like that. That is not my target. What I will say is, I will only consider the, I mean, I will talk about the statistical properties. In other words, suppose I consider a volume of some size, what is the average number of galaxies I will see? Okay. And then I can go to higher order moments, like correlation function, variance and other things, and power spectrum. These things I will define very soon. So the point is, the quantities to consider are statistical quantities. I mean, we are not going to compare our model with the observations point by point. Because there is no point in trying to compare point by point. It's all a random field anyway. So if this is a random field, and our universe is like one realization of the random field. Now the problem with random fields is, or the way to deal with random fields is to consider what are known as ensembles. So mentally what you have to do is, you have to take our universe, make some infinite number of copies of it. Okay? Exactly, and then each of them will have, each of them should be considered as different realizations of the same random field. So all these ensembles should have the same statistical properties, but again point to point they will vary. So that is the limit in which we have to work. So all our statistical quantities should be defined in terms of ensembles and ensemble average and things like that. So let us say, for example, I have rho x, okay, the density field. So this I will call as the ensemble average of the density field. So what am I doing? I have some 1,000 copies of the universe, and so on. So you go to any x, let us say this x. So I go to this ensemble, calculate the rho. I go to the same point in this ensemble, calculate the rho, and so on. And then I sum it over and divide by the number of ensembles I consider. So that is nothing but the average. So this is ensemble average rho form. And similarly, whenever I say ensemble average, mentally you should keep this picture in mind. Now, we know, the assumption, the cosmological principle, the assumption under which the whole theory is being built, tells me that the universe is homogeneous. Okay. Actually, the strict word to use is the universe is statistically homogeneous. In other words, no point is special. Okay. No point is preferred than the other. Which means, if I do ensemble average, then this quantity should actually be independent of x. So in other words, if I do the ensemble average over infinite number of ensembles here, and then I take another point here, statistical homogeneity implies that they should give the same value. Otherwise, you can actually distinguish between points. You can actually rate the points depending on the densities they have, at least in terms of ensemble averages. So that is not allowed. So which means this quantity is independent of it can depend on time. Whatever we are doing is just one snapshot, one instant of time. So this will probably vary with time, and we know that for dark matter variance it will vary as AQ, but that's a different story. Okay, so this should be independent of x. So then let us rigorously define our density contrast. So density contrast, I will now define it as rho x by the ensemble average minus 1. Now this is density. You can do the same thing with quantities like correlation function. So what is the correlation function? Correlation function is a correlation between two points x1 and x2, and it is essentially defined as the ensemble average of delta at x1 and delta at x2. Okay, so here I have talked about one point. Now what you will do is you will take two points, any two points x1 and x2, and you will calculate delta here and delta here, multiply, and then go to another ensemble and do the same thing, then add them over and then divide by the number of ensembles. That is the quantity you will take. Okay, you can think of it as like the higher order moment. There was a mean here, higher order moment, which is like variance. So this is something like variance, but slightly more complicated. Now let us see what statistical homogeneity implies here. So if statistical homogeneity is true, then psi of x1 and x2, which is this quantity, should be same as psi at x1 plus, let us say, some y, and x2 plus y, and y can be anything. Okay? In other words, I take these two points and shift them by, so I just translate them by the same amount, I should get the same value if homogeneity is there. It's like just, I'm just changing my origin, and that should not change the value of this, the statistical homogeneity. So that implies that psi, okay, will be a function of just x1 minus x2. So it cannot be a function of x1, x2 separately, but it will be a function of only the difference between them. That is not the case, then statistical homogeneity will be violated. Now can you tell me, now this is all about statistical homogeneity, but we also have statistical isotropy, right? In other words, no matter which direction I look, okay, or no matter how I orient my axis, well, I mean, the universe should look the same. Then if I enforce the statistical isotropy on this, can you tell me what should be the extra constraint I will have on this function? Yeah, exactly. So statistical isotropy will tell you that this will only depend on the distance between two points. In other words, suppose I take two points like this, and suppose in the next time I take two points like this, okay, things should not change provided the distance between them is same. Okay, so statistical homogeneity, statistical isotropy. So this is called correlation function. Now comes the practical question. Now, of course, I have been telling you that I am doing all these things to match with the observation. Now, so that means if I am trying to, let us say I have a model which gives me the correlation function for our universe, or maybe the mean density or whatever for our universe. Now I have to match the observation. So this I can calculate from model. Okay, in the worst case, I will do simulations. I will do thousands of simulations, each starting with different initial conditions, but having the same statistical property. I mean, I can calculate this theoretically. The question is, when I have to go observationally, how do I calculate? Because observationally I don't have thousands of ensembles, right? I have just one universe. Okay? So that is the difficulty with astrophysics or cosmology as such. There is no, what is known as, I mean, you cannot design experiments and repeat them. So somebody has given you the universe, you have to just go and observe that and try to determine, I mean how it works and what it looks like and things like that. Okay, so it is more of a detective work. Okay, you don't have control on the system. Okay, so there are no controlled experiments. So whatever crime has been committed already, and you have been given the crime scene. And now whatever indications you have to deduce what is going on there. Okay, so that is the idea. So given this, now I have to find a way to do ensemble equivalent of ensemble averages, but with just one ensemble. Now you know, this is nothing new. This is also done in statistical mechanics, where you talk about ensemble averages, and then you replace ensemble average with something like time average or something like that. Okay. Here time average won't work. We are working on one snapshot. So the only average I can do at this stage is what is known as the volume average. So what I can do is, given an ensemble, I can calculate the delta or the rho at every point there and calculate the average. So question is, how do I know that is same as the ensemble average? Okay. So at least we should have some idea about what kind of conditions we should apply to the volume average so that it becomes equivalent to the ensemble average. So let us say, so what I do is, when I do volume average, so let us formally define. So let us say I take the delta and average over a volume of size V. And then I have to do a 1 by V. So just see whether you understand this expression. Okay. What I have done is, I have gone and centered myself around point X, constructed the volume V, whichever shape. This is not important at this stage. So suppose I have constructed a volume V around that. So that volume element is essentially given by X prime. So I will just calculate the delta x plus x primes. Okay. So I will just calculate the deltas at all the points in that volume, sum them over, that is the integration, and just normalize. Okay. Since there is a dq of x prime, I should normalize it by total volume. You can put minus as well, but it doesn't matter. Okay. Statistical homogeneity will give you the same. So now, the thing is, now let us say, so you can, I haven't told you, this is defined for any volume. Okay? So you go to a point, you can construct any volume, you can construct a volume of this shape, you can construct a cube if you want. So a good thing to construct is something which is spherically symmetric, so that you can exploit the statistical isotropy. So what we will consider is, for example, a sphere. Okay? So what I am saying is, I will go to a point, construct a sphere of radius x, capital X, okay, which has a volume V, which is nothing but 4 pi by 3 x cube. Okay, and so then I will just calculate the deltas, find the deltas at all these points, sum them over, which is essentially integrating, and that will be my average delta, average over this big sphere. Okay. So let me just for completeness sake define it. So this will be, there are 4 pi x cube by 3 inverse. And then there is a d cube x prime. Okay, let me, one has to be careful. So we will write it as theta capital X. One minus, that's also fine. Yeah. So you are centered around X. You are going to all the points X prime. Yeah, this sounds fine. No, let me, okay, sorry. write it slightly differently. So I'm measuring x prime from the origin of the sphere. Okay, so I will take only those x primes which are smaller, I mean which distances are smaller than x. Okay, so that is ensured by the theta function because that is where the sphere is. And so the coordinates are nothing but x plus x prime, because I mean as far as this sphere is concerned, the center is at x. So all the points are given by x plus x prime. Okay, if you put the minus, then whatever I wrote earlier will come. So this you should just check and convince yourself. So I am saying that fine. So this is the volume average. Number one. I still haven't told, I mean, so the question I have to ask is this volume average equivalent to ensemble average? Okay, so that is the question we have to answer. So to do that, let us do the first thing, which is to calculate the ensemble average of this quantity. So remember, this quantity you can go to each and every ensemble, go to the corresponding point x. Take a point x, go to the first ensemble, take the point x, draw a sphere of size capital X, calculate this quantity. You can go to the second one, do the same thing, the third one, do the same thing, and so on. So the question is, what is the ensemble average of this quantity? And this is simply to show. So the ensemble average of this quantity, if I take ensemble average, what will happen is, okay, let me do it here. If I take ensemble average, none of these depend on ensembles. Okay, capital X is something I have chosen, theta function is theta function. So the only where the ensemble average will come is this. Okay, this by definition is 0. Okay, so the ensemble average of this quantity is 0. Okay. So in other words, if you take a point, construct a sphere, go to the next one, again construct, take the same point, construct the sphere and so on, and add them up, we will get a z. So the question is, does this mean that, have I proved that ensemble average is same as volume average? What do you think? Is this the proof of ensemble average being same as volume average? In other words, suppose I have just one ensemble and I calculate this quantity. Okay, I cannot calculate the ensemble average, but just calculate this volume average. Okay? Will that be zero? It won't, right? It won't be zero. I mean, you don't know. I mean, it will depend on the density field. So if we go to this point, make a sphere, I mean, there is no guarantee that this will be zero. It will be zero if I sum over all the ensembles. Okay? Someone will give me positive values, someone will give me negative values, and they will average up. So this quantity by itself is not telling me that volume average is same as ensemble average. In other words, I go here, and construct this sphere and find a value, I cannot say that that is the average value of this quantity. Okay, that is not valid. Now, how do I know that something is a true representative of the ensemble average? So to do that, let us imagine that you are doing this thing. Okay. You are going to the same point, constructing sphere. I know that on average they will give me 0. So let us say this one gives me plus 2, this one gives me minus 3, this one gives me plus 1 or something like that, this one gives me minus 1, some plus 3 and something. It goes on. But at the end all of them average up to 0. Then this quantity is not good, right? Then I will only have one ensemble. Probably if I average over that, I will probably get the value as large as maybe 3 or 2 or something like that. And that is quite far from 0. That is something I don't want. Okay, so this, if that is the case, then this is not a good quantity to work with. But suppose instead of this, you find that this same thing is actually, for this thing is giving 0.02 and this is giving 0.0. 0.03 and 0.01, let us say. Okay, and so on. They are very, depending on how small you want. Then you will say that fine, okay. I mean, of course, I don't expect it to exactly give 0 every time. But these are quite small numbers, okay. These are probably 2% errors. And fine, 2% errors is something I can live with. So then this is fine. Then you will say that, okay. Then I will consider this sphere as a representative of the ensemble average. Remember, the ensemble average should give you 0. What I am trying to find is what kind of volume I should average out, so average, so that I get a value which is very close to 0. Okay, how close to 0 will depend on your requirements. But I want to know the condition, how to make it smaller and smaller. So mathematically, how do I estimate this, that what kind of volume I should choose to make this very close to 0? So mathematically, what you have to do is you have to calculate the quantity, which is the variance. In other words, if you average all these things out, this will be 0. But if I every time take square of it, then the negatives will also give me positive. So every time you deviate from the mean, you will just add up. Okay. So if it was plus 2, minus 3 and large values, you will see that this one will also be a large value. Okay. It will be of the order of 2 or 3. Whereas if these are small values, this one will also be a small value of the order of 0.02, 0.03 or what. Okay. So this is probably the quantity I should calculate and try to see whether this is a small quantity. So if I can show that this quantity goes to 0, which means the variation from between ensemble, I mean one ensemble and the other ensemble is negligible. Okay. Suppose this one goes is very small. Then the variation between ensemble to ensemble is negligible. So that means if I measure in one ensemble, that's it. Okay, I don't have to go and measure. I mean, I don't need many ensembles to do that. So the trick is to calculate this quantity. And this is a lengthy calculation. So let me just give you the steps. So let's go through this. So that 4 pi x cube by 3, I will call it V for the moment. So I have a 1 by V, then I have to integrate over d cube x prime, okay, and then there will be a theta function of x minus x prime, and then I will have a delta x plus x prime, that is the first delta x, but then I have to make another one, which I have called it d cube, for example, y prime, and then theta x minus y prime delta x plus y prime, and then I have to take the ensemble average of this whole quantity. This is what I have to do. So here I will just outline the steps. We can't go into full details. So this 1 by V is something which doesn't depend on the ensemble. The integrations are also like this. Theta functions don't depend on the ensemble. What depends on the ensemble are this one. Y prime. Okay. Now what is this quantity? This is just a correlation function. So this I should be able to write it as zeta of x prime minus y prime. Okay. Now the tricks are you have to introduce, so this is the part I will skip the steps. So you can introduce a new vector which is, let us say, x prime minus y prime. Okay. So you can take away one of the variables, replace it with z prime. Okay, and then you will have two theta functions. And you have to do it carefully and convince yourself that these two theta functions are essentially will give you the overlap between two spheres, separated at two distances. So these are like, this is a sphere which is centered at x prime, has radius x. This is a sphere which is centered at y prime, has radius x. Okay? And this integration essentially means you are just calculating the volume of the overlap region between them. Okay? For example, if they are separated beyond 2x, then this will actually give you 0. Okay? If it is less than that, you will get some overlap. So this is a geometrical problem in that sense. So essentially you can work this thing out. So I will only write the final result. The final result tells me that this will be delta. It will have 1 by v only, 0 to x, okay, dx prime, so this is the kind of the volume element, then you will have a psi of 2x. That's the only thing that will remain. And then there will be that overlap thing. So I'm just writing it. It won't play an important role here, but you can check whether what you have done is correct. Okay, this is something which will come out from that overlap volume. So remember, our target is to show that this should be very close to zero, or at least find the conditions under which this becomes negligible. So you can see in general, this is not negligible, and it crucially depends on what is this correlation function. Okay. So the correlation function is high at every scales of interest, then it's gone. You cannot actually make your volume average equivalent to ensemble average. You are essentially stuck. So what do you, so let us say I define a scale of decorrelation. So which is, I define psi of 2i equal to 0 when y is greater than something which I am calling as scale of decorrelation. So DC is decorrelation. So suppose I assume that psi can have, I don't know what form psi has. But suppose I say that psi is 0, or it becomes negligible. 0 means it is so small that you don't have to account for it anymore. So psi is 0 for very large scales. Okay. How large? Let us say a scale which is larger than some value, xdc. Then you will be able to show, you have to just put this back here. So this integral will become something like 0 to xdc only. And you will be able to show that delta x square x will be x cube by x dc. Yeah, x dc cube by x cube. And there will be a term which is xi at 2 xi f sorry 2y is 0 when y when only when y is greater than so xi at 2xdc is 0 and so on I mean xi at 2y is 0 only when y is greater than xdc in other words yeah so fine this is how I am defining so at psi is going to 0 above some scale. Oh, okay. So what you will do is you will break this integral from 0 to xdc and xdc to x. Okay, so xdc to x you will just ignore. So it will be just 0 to xdc. And yeah, that's the main. So it will end up with something like this. And so this can be made arbitrarily small if I take x to be much much larger than xdc. Okay, there is a cubic factor. You don't have to go much larger. Okay, even a factor of 2 will give you almost a factor of 10 here. But essentially, this is the mathematical way of saying this. So what does it mean? It means that this quantity can go to 0 provided there is a scale of decorrelation. And I have to average over scales which are larger than the scale of decorrelation. Okay. Only then this will go to 0. Now whether the scale of decorrelation exists or not, I mean that you have to check from observations whether our universe allows such a thing. Now, you can convince yourself that what happens when you go beyond scale of decorrelation? This is essentially telling you that delta of x plus y and delta of x minus y, this average is 0 for y greater than xdc. This is the same statement, right? So what I am saying is you center yourself around a point, go to y direction here and go to y direction on the other side, correct? And just calculate this quantity. And that, if it is sufficiently large, then this should go to 0. Now, this is same, if you should convince yourself that this is same as saying that at sufficiently large scales, the universe looks homogeneous to us. Okay, which is what the whole cosmology is based on. And that scale of homogeneity is typically of the order of 100 megapascals. Okay. So, that is very similar to the scale of decorrelation as well. So that is the scale. So if I go and take two points at 100 megaparsecs apart, okay, 50 this way and 50 that way, okay, then these two things would be completely uncorrelated. So I go to various ensembles, it should not change from ensemble to ensemble, essentially. Okay. That is the statement of homogeneity. So the fact that we have a scale of homogeneity tells me that if I actually average over such large scales, then the variation point to point goes to 0 or ensemble to ensemble goes to 0. And then I can treat this average as truly representative of the ensemble average. Okay. So in other words, if you try to average over a small sphere, okay, maybe 10 megaparsec, and try to calculate the density, let us say, and say that this is the average density of the universe, you will be wrong. But if you actually take this sphere as large as 100 megaparsec, calculate any average quantity you want, and say that, okay, fine, this is representative of the ensemble average, then you are probably right. Okay, so that is what this thing tells you, actually how to find the equivalence between ensemble average and the volume average. Now this I have done it only for the density field, okay? For the over density contrast field. You can do the same thing for example, correlation. If you try to calculate correlation, again you have just one ensemble, okay? So you have to take pair of points, okay? But how many points will you take? What is the volume you should take to calculate the average correlation? And you have to go through the same sort of exercise, except the correlation, see to calculate the variance of the density, we needed correlation. To calculate the variance of the correlation, you will need what is known as the 4-point function. Okay? And you can still make similar arguments and show that at what scales it happens. And that is regularly done in observation. No, the introduction of XDC, okay. So, fact is that, okay, this is not equal to zero. So, introduce XDC to tell you that if such a scale exists, then I can show that it can go to zero at scales larger than that. Whether such a scale exists depends on the universe, okay? Depends on what, how psi x actually varies in our universe. So, in this quantity, delta xx, I mean, at the limit x much, much larger than xdc. Okay. These quantities are called what are known as estimators. So, I want to calculate the ensemble average, but I actually cannot calculate an ensemble average because I don't have ensemble. Okay. So, I have to somehow estimate the ensemble average. And it turns out that this is an estimator of that ensemble average. So, this is something which is very widely used in statistics. These are the things you will also use in CMB. I mean, the same derivation will go through when you try to calculate variance in temperature and things like that. So, these are some things to keep in mind. Okay. Now, let us define few more quantities which are of interest. So, now often interchangeably use these two quantities. So, this is ensemble average and this is the volume average. Okay. Rho bar is average over a volume. So whenever I say volume average, I will assume that it is average over a sufficiently large one. So that is the next thing. Now the next quantity of interest is what is known as the power spectrum. Now what is power spectrum? You take delta x and you take its Fourier transform. Okay. So what you will have is delta k, which is nothing but d cube x delta x into d I a dot d. Let us see the convention I am using. Here I am using minus. So this is the Fourier transform. Now let us try to calculate the quantity delta star k delta k prime and its ensemble average. Okay, so just like we did it for the real space, okay, I wanted to do it for the Fourier space as well. Now you can see that delta k in generally can be complex. Okay, this is I. Here. So let us take one complex conjugate. So to do this, so let me show you how to do these calculations are very useful in cosmology. So you take the first one and then you take the second one. Okay, so this I can write it as d cube x prime e to the I a dot. Now I will do it in two steps. First, so this is, I mean, you see what you have got is a correlation function here. Okay? Let us assume that we are living in a universe which is just statistically homogeneous. Okay? I will I want to do it in two steps, just to show you the effect of statistical homogeneity and statistical isotropy separately on the quantity which we are deriving. So delta star k, delta k prime should be dqx prime, okay, e to the I k dot x minus k prime dot x prime, and I'm calling it a psi x minus x prime. I haven't put the mod yet. Okay, so I am assuming that this is just statistically homogeneous. So if that is the case, then the idea would be to define a new variable, which is y prime equal to, let us say, x prime minus x. Okay, you will have to put this back here. So what I will do is I will jump a few steps here. So this will be, you have to do the Jacobian carefully and show that this is correct. Dq y prime, then e to the I k x, x prime is y prime plus x, a dot y prime plus x, and this has become y prime. Okay, so you will see that this is dqx into the I k minus k prime dot x, and then dq y prime into the okay, this is what we mean. This part depends on x and this depends on y prime. Okay, I've separated out the integrals. So now can somebody tell me what is the value of this integral? It's the delta function, right? So in fact, we will be able to show that this is 2 pi cube times the Dirac delta function of k minus k prime. Okay. And you end up with a quantity which is this. This quantity is nothing but the Fourier transform of the correlation function. Okay? And that is essentially what is known as power spectrum. And you can see this is a function of k prime. Okay? But since the delta function is there, you can write it as a function of Ek as well. Okay? So this quantity is known as the power spectrum. Power spectrum of density fluctuations. So it is related to the ensemble average by this. Okay? And it is also nothing but the Fourier transform of the correlation function. Okay. This is something which is widely used in things like signal processing, okay, when you are dealing with signals, electrical signals. Now, you see something interesting has happened. So I have only invoked statistical homogeneity, and that tells me that modes which have different values of k and k prime are uncorrelated. Okay? The moment when k and k prime are different, this is zero. Okay? So two different k modes are uncorrelated. This is a consequence of statistical homogeneity. Same thing is not true in X space. Okay? That is why people prefer to work in Fourier space, because there you can treat different K modes almost independent of each other. Okay? And in linear theory it is very interesting, because we also know that different K modes will evolve independently. Okay? If you write down the equations of delta, you can separate out the t and the k part, And different K-modes evolve independently, they are uncorrelated, so they are actually very easy to deal with. Okay. Now, we are left with statistical isotropy that we haven't invoked yet. So if you write Pk as some d cube x e to the minus I k dot x psi of x. Okay. But at this point, let us invoke statistical isotropy. So this just becomes a function of x, a mod of x. Okay. If that is the case, what you can do is, you should be able to write this one as kx cos theta. K dot x becomes kx cos theta. D cube x, you can break it up into your d phi d cos theta and x squared dx and so on. And you will be able to show that this function is given by times psi x and then sin kx . Okay, this is what we will get. So that tells you that pk, which was initially a function of the vector k, is now essentially just a function of the magnitude of k. It doesn't depend on the actual vector k. Okay, so that is the effect of statistical isotropy. It does not matter which way the vector is oriented. It depends only on the magnitude of the vector. That is something, again, it's probably not unexpected, but it's something good to know. So I will take a few more minutes to introduce to you a few more quantities, and then we will postpone the rest for the afternoon's class. So, interesting, very useful quantity of interest is what is known as sigma square. Yeah.
In the second step,
yes. In general, no, but in this case, yes. But I mean, okay, that's true. So, yeah, so the quantity which is which can be calculated observationally. So, what you will do is you will actually go construct spheres of radius x and calculate the fluctuations in that. Okay. And then you can try to plot. Again, you can see that this quantity should be very small when x crosses the decorrelation limit. Okay. But smaller than that, it will have some value. And that will contain actually information about the correlation function. In other words, this will also contain information about the power spectrum. Okay. It will contain information about the density fluctuation. Okay, so I go to the sky, draw spheres of different radius, just increase it. Okay, essentially drawing and just plot this quantity as a function of x. Okay, that gives me some idea about how this correlation function or whatever on the power spectrum, how it actually varies with scales. Okay, so that tells you that how much power I have at different scales. And the good thing is different cosmological models will actually predict different forms of this sigma square. Just to complete the story, I can actually, in terms of power spectrum, this can be written as 0 to infinity. Then I will have 3 sine x minus Okay, this is if you choose w to be a theta function, then you can show that this sigma square is actually directly related to the power spectrum through this. Okay, how is it related to the correlation function? We have already derived. Okay, while doing that ensemble average, volume average, UQ value. So this is just to tell you how it depends on the power spectrum. So maybe I can spend 5 more minutes to tell you one more thing which is extremely important. So this is all about, the mean and the correlation and things like that. But actually, if you ask the question, what is the distribution of the field? In other words, suppose I go, okay, take a large volume, okay, let us say a huge volume of the universe, calculate the deltas at every point. Go to every point and calculate. I want to ask, what is the probability distribution function of this delta? In other words, how many points have values delta between some delta and d delta? Okay. And I want to bin them up and just plot what is known as the probability distribution function. So again, initially people just assume this to be a Gaussian. Okay. So it follows a Gaussian distribution function centered around mean, okay, and this has some weight. Okay, at least the initial field, people assumed it to be Gaussian. Of course, once you let it evolve, we don't know what will happen. Nonlinearities will take over and various things will happen. But the initial field was assumed to be Gaussian because of some philosophical reasons and some ad hoc arguments. But now we know observationally that it is indeed Gaussian. Okay, when you actually go and observe the CMB perturbation and try to find out, how much non-Gaussian it is has, you will see that there is no evidence of any non-Gaussian. You have very high degree of accuracy. Okay, it's very highly Gaussian. So that is the assumption people work on. So essentially, which means that this P delta is nothing but, I can write it as 1 by sigma root 2 by e to the minus delta square by 2 sigma square. This, when I just write sigma square, it essentially means sigma square and x equal to 0. It is nothing but delta square. Sigma is nothing but the variance of the Gaussian. Okay. That's what it is. Suppose I want to calculate the probability distribution of something slightly more complicated. Suppose I want to calculate the probability distribution that point 1 has a probability delta 1, a over density delta 1, and point 2 has over density delta 2. Okay. Does somebody know how to calculate this? Yes. And delta 2. Okay, is that it? Yes, there is a correlation term. Exactly. So the problem is, if you work in real space, two different points are correlated. Okay? And that correlation is precisely given by the correlation function, okay, zeta. Okay? So unless zeta is 0, you cannot work with this approximation. And then you will end up getting something which is complicated. So just for completeness, let me write it for you. And in principle, you can write the same thing for some, n number of points. Okay. So let me just write it. It will be proportional to, I'm leaving out the proportionality constant. So it will be 1 by 2, 1 minus xi square. Okay, well, xi is the correlation between the two points. And then you will have delta 1 square by sigma 1 square. In case they are different, of course in a homogeneous universe they are not. So delta 2 square by sigma 2 square minus 2 psi delta 1 delta 2 by something more sigma 1. So if the correlation is not present, then this is fine. You will have just delta 1 square plus delta 2 square by sigma 1 square. If the correlation is present, you will have this all these extra. If you have, you can write such an expression for n points as well. You will end up with a n cross n correlation matrix. So the diagonal elements will give you all the sigmas, and off-diagonal elements will give you all the correlations. And that can always be done. You can also see that there is a natural advantage in working in Fourier space. Had I written the same thing in the Fourier space, then there is no correlation because two different modes are uncorrelated. Okay? So it is just the power spectrum which will appear. So instead of sigma, you will have the power spectrum hanging. And that's it, nothing else. So that is the advantage of working in Fourier space. So often computationally people just go, or even observationally people take the density field and go to the Fourier space, and then there people try to compare results with each other. Also in CMB you would have seen people compare what is known as CL. Okay. So what you actually observe is theta, which is equivalent of x, right? But people take a equivalent of Fourier transform, not Fourier transform, this is a Legendre's transform in CMB. But you go to CL where things become uncorrelated. And it is easier to deal with. So that is why most of the time people will talk about power spectrum rather than correlation function. I mean, both contain in principle equivalent amount of information. But it is often easier to deal with in the Fourier space. But just keep this in mind that the random field which I have been talking about till now to a very high degree of accuracy is a Gaussian random field initially. When everything was linear, this was a Gaussian random field. When it evolved, then things started evolving very badly and highly nonlinear structures formed, galaxies formed. Of course, if you see the field now, that is definitely not Gaussian. It is not Gaussian. There are a high degree of non-Gaussian it is. But that is arising because of non-linearities. So there is no primordial non-Gaussianity. In other words, the initial field is free from non-Gaussianity. To a very high degree of accuracy, as we know today, it is Gaussian. And that is the approximation with which we will work. So in the afternoon class, I will tell you how to calculate, I won't be able to do it completely, how to calculate the PK from theory and how does it compare with observations we know today. I mean, what are the effects which determine PK? Okay, that's the first thing we will do. And then we will actually, our target is to calculate, for example, the number of galaxies or the number of halos with a given mass at some redshift z. Okay. This is a quantity which can be directly compared with observations. You can actually calculate the galaxy having a luminosity and you should be able to match it with this thing. So that is something I will show you how to calculate theoretically. And that is where we will stop. And if you want to learn more, you have to do it yourself beyond that. Any questions?